right.
The line in church, or I think anywhere, is the rule. Something like that. Jared. Pam, don't be prideful. You decided the other day, it was late in the evening and it was dark, and you decided, let's go out. And you were driving around and you just happened to be in so-and-so's neighborhood. You know who so-and-so is, right? Church member. Church member's neighborhood. And you decided to stop in there, and you were going to stop by for a visit. Hey, that one works. So, as you roll up, you know, your spouse is saying, it's too late. We shouldn't stop. They might be in their pajamas because Pastor Trey's got his pajamas on at like 5 o'clock in the evening these days. So these people might, maybe, you know, they don't want. So how do you decide if they're home or not? How do you decide if they're awake or not? What do you do as you roll up? You text them? What? Yeah, you flash the lights at them. Is that what you do? Usually you could tell if they're home or not if they got their lights on, right? If the lights are on, like, well, they're home anyway, and it looks like they're up. I can see the little glowing blue light in the living room, so I think they're up. That a little lamp in the window is a good sign that someone's home. You can hardly see the light on in this now because I think the batteries are running low, but this is going to be my object lesson today. So pretend like you're impressed. Everybody say, ah. The glow of a nice picture, the glow of a nice warm light in the window that faces the road. It tells you that someone's home, right? And maybe there's food on the table. Maybe, right? Maybe you're coming home from somewhere and you see the glow of that warm light in the window, and you know as soon as the door opens you can smell dinners on the table. Maybe it means that there is a nice, warm, soft chair just for you to come in. The glow of a nice, warm light says, stay a while. Somebody's elbowing somebody else saying, we need to turn out the lights a little sooner in the evening. But when that light's there, maybe it means, hey, come on in, relax, and stay a while. Would you guys say, stay a while? That's been our theme for this passage of Scripture when we've been discussing prayer. Because when we learn to stay a while in His presence, His light inside of us begins to grow, doesn't it? Do you guys remember how Moses would spend this time with the Lord and he didn't realize it? But when he came down off the mountain to speak to the Israelites, they couldn't look at him because he was just glowing with this light of God's glory. And so they said, hey, you're kind of bright. And he said, well, thank you. And they said, no, what we mean is it's hurting our eyes. And so he veiled his face. Remember that? And then the New Testament, the Apostle Paul says, the glory of the New Testament is even brighter than that. You guys remember those things? So when we spend this time alone, when we spend this time with God and his presence and settled in, his light begins to grow in us and we begin to see that someone lives here. And others begin to see, someone lives here. So today we're going to learn to pray that the warm light of God's presence shines out from ourselves as individuals, as well as from our congregation. Maybe more importantly, as well as from our congregation. So we're going to take just a moment now before we go any further. We're going to read this passage and then we're going to pray. And maybe a little bit of a different way. We're going to be church today. We're going to do church today because it's boring just to come and listen, right? It's boring just to come and sit. So we're going to move a bit. We're going to do something in our prayer time today. Would you stand with me and turn to Ephesians 3? Now, you know you can take any passage of Scripture and pray it for other people, right? And you know you're praying a biblical, spirit-inspired prayer at that point, if you decide to do that. It gets a little tricky when you're reading the Song of Solomon or some other numbers or something like that. But there are many prayers in Scripture, and this is one in Ephesians 3, verses 14 to 19. We're going to spend a couple more weeks on this prayer. But you can pray this prayer for other people. So if you find Ephesians 3, 14, would you just put your little ribbon marker there or your page marker there, bookmark, and hold that spot because I do want us to use this in just a moment. But let me get one of you to read Ephesians 3, 14 to 19. 14 to 19, if you just read that out loud for us, we're going to do this as an act of worship. So we'll follow along, and if you would just read that out loud for us, we'll go with you on it. Ephesians 3, 14. The entire camp said, amen. Before you're seated, this is what I'd like to invite you to do. I want us to pray this prayer over one another. Not for yourselves. We pray for ourselves enough. I want us to pray this prayer for somebody else. And you can stay right where you are in your seat if you'd like to. Whatever your comfort zone is, stretch out of it just a little bit at least, but maybe a lot. But you can stay right where you are and pray this prayer, maybe for the person right beside you, maybe a spouse or a child. Maybe it'll be a quiet prayer. Maybe it'll be a whisper prayer, Ephesians 3, 14 to 19. But I want to encourage the rest of you, maybe this illustration is just helpful for me. Maybe it'd be helpful for some of you. How many of you enjoy going to the beach? Anybody at all like the beach? Okay. How many of you like the pool in the summertime? Anybody at all like the pool? Okay. Picture the air temperature is perfect, Addison. The water temperature is perfect. That doesn't always happen. Picture it does. And then you walk out and you don't have to jump in. You don't have to surprise yourself and go into a heart attack. The temperature is just perfect. So you can walk slowly into the water and wade in up to your chest. Can you picture it? Okay, now look about the room. This is your ocean. This is your pool. Ready? In just a moment, Jerry, I'm going to get you to play some quiet music for us. I just want you to step wade out there. Wade out there. And maybe someone around you, maybe someone across the room, just kind of wade in here. Find somebody. Maybe you'll put your hand on their shoulder. Maybe you'll just stand beside them. And maybe you'll pray quietly, or maybe you'll whisper prayer this over this person. But can we do that? All right, so any one of those things. If you want to stay where you are, that's fine. But some of you, wade on out in there and find somebody just to pray this prayer over them. Ready, set, go.
Yeah.
Father God, I give you thanks for this congregation and these families. And I pray for each one of them that you would strengthen them, reinforce their foundation, anchor them in their sweet personal relationship with you, Father God. I pray that you would, in their times of quiet prayer, in their times of group worship, that they would get glimpses of the dimensions of your love for them, that they would see the endless horizons of your love and see how big it is and how much you love them. And I pray this would refresh their souls. And then I pray that this would build and become a normal, regular experience so that they would all reach the point of being filled up with the fullness of you. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you guys say this maybe as a sermon to each other? Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Bump somebody, says, your love never fails and never gives up, and never runs out on me. One more time. Your love never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Amen. Like old church. Amen. Oh, amen. You're right. Amen. I thought maybe I could get away with just fading that one out at the end, but appreciate you guys helping out with that one. Okay. Uncomfortable. I'm not going to ask you if that was uncomfortable or not. Does that matter? I don't know. Was that good? Can we do that? Can we do that more often to pray for each other? Okay. Most of you said no. Okay. No, I don't know about that one, Pastor Trey. We like the part where you talk and we listen. No, it doesn't fly here at the camp, does it? It's always good to be ministering, to be serving. The Lord pours into us all the time, and so we give that out. We need it, don't we? Folks that don't ask for prayer, some of those folks need it more than anybody else, don't they? And the only way you're going to get it, they're going to get it, is if you surprise them. Surprise, I'm praying for you. So let's settle down in Ephesians 3 here together. And Ephesians 3, 14 to 19 is just one example of how a passage that we can pray over people so that our prayers don't have to be boring, so that our prayers don't have to be repetitious, and so that our prayers don't have to be kooky. If you're worried about praying something wrong or messing up, which is hard to do, but if you're worried about that, pray scripture for somebody, especially prayers and scriptures. Good. It's really good. So let's settle down in Ephesians 3, and I'm going to use two different illustrations today. There's some layers of meaning in this passage, and so I want to use two different illustrations. I want to approach this passage from two angles. I want us to see what this passage means to individuals. What does it mean to Trey as an individual? Because this is my knee-jerk reaction. This is my default mode, which is a weakness. But is to read every passage as if it's specifically just aimed at Trey. But after we do that, we get a good grip on it. That is important. After we do that, we're going to spend some time looking at what this passage means, more importantly, to the congregation. Okay? So hang on and let's work through this together. Ephesians chapter 3. Paul addressed individuals as well as a group. And we know that because he said things like, you know, I want you to know as all the saints should know. I want you guys to know as all the saints should know what is the width and length and depth and height of the love of Christ. And to the individual, the Apostle Paul prays something like this. This is my summary of what he prays. I am praying that Father God would fortify you so that you can grasp the love of Christ and reach the goal of being filled with God. Let me put that, yeah, there it is. Would you guys read that with me? This is our summary of Ephesians 3, 14 to 19. Ready? I'm praying that Father God would fortify you so that you can grasp the love of Christ and reach the goal of being filled with God. Okay, let's spend some time on that just for a moment. Here's the first part, verse 14. Paul says, "For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." This is just one prayer posture, right? Just one. There are several in Scripture. "From whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named." He is the Father of the family of all families, the one family. And we're thankful that though we used to be orphans, we believed on the gospel and have been adopted into the family of God. How many of you are thankful for that? Say amen. Say, I am. "That he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened or fortified or reinforced with might or mightiness through his Spirit in the inner man, Christ dwelling in your hearts through faith." And then he says, "you being rooted and grounded in love." In these first few verses, the prayer is that we would be fortified, reinforced, more lumber added, more screws added, more concrete added, so that when the hurricanes of life approach and thunder in, we will be unmoved in our relationship with Father God. You know, folks, most folks who get derailed from the faith, who go shipwrecked from the faith, as Paul would put it, most of those folks do it because either there's a sin they wanted to do really bad, so they decided God doesn't exist, or usually because something bad has happened in their life, and how could God allow that to happen? So we've spent some time discussing that in the past, and we've talked about the Lord's providence, but here the point is, Paul says, I'm praying for you to be founded, rooted, grounded, fortified, reinforced, so that when you settle into your time with God and that relationship with him, you won't be moved. Satan tries to push you and pull you, and the winds begin to blow and howl. You'll stay right there where you are. Paul says, I'm praying that Father God would, I'm using the word fortify you. And then here's the second part, verse 18. "That you may be able to comprehend and to know," to comprehend and to know, "to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and the height of the love of Christ, and to know the love of Christ, which actually passes knowledge." It's so huge, all you're going to be able to do is stand up on the precipice and see it stretching out for miles. But that's enough. That's enough. If you get that it's endless in its horizons, then you'll understand. Now keep this in mind. Here Paul prays this way, so that you can grasp the love of Christ. You can grasp it. Because you don't naturally grasp it. You think you do, but you don't. We don't naturally get it. You need to spend time. Now, remember this. I want to point this out as we go. I pointed this out last week. There are three words that are used in this passage that show us the structure of it. And these are important. And it's this little Greek word, hina, which means in order that or so that. Now, in English, you might have a bunch of that's in this passage, but I want to show you where they are in Greek, okay? Because this is why I've built the sermon this way. There is one in verse 16, that, in order that, so that he would grant you. I am praying so that, this is the first one, so that he would fortify you. Here's the second one. I know you see it in other places in English. They're trying to make sense of the passage in English, and they need to put words in there to do that. But here's where it appears again in Greek, in verse 18. At the beginning of verse 18, so that, here's the next thing. I'm praying this in verse 16, so that he would fortify you, so that, in verse 18, you would grasp his love. And then here's the next one. It's in the middle of verse 19. So that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now, why is that important? Because do you guys hear it? He's building. Can you hear the building? I'm praying this, so that this, so that this. In other words, that means the end of verse 19 is what? The reason, the what? The final part, there's a word I'm looking for. We use it, The crescendo, yes, it's reaching a climax. Paul doesn't just start off by saying, I'm praying that you'll be filled with the fullness of God. He doesn't start off that way. He prays a prayer that makes logical and spiritual sense to him. It is a prayer that builds to the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal is that they would be filled with all the fullness of God. Ready? So he gets to this point. I'm praying that you would reach the goal, the last hina, the last so that, reach the goal of being filled with the fullness of God. Is that a little thing or a big thing? Shout it out to me. Help me out. That's a big thing. This is the goal of the prayer. I mean, come on. There's somebody struggling and you're not sure what to pray for them. If you pray that for them, do you think that would pretty much cover it? Yeah, that'd pretty much cover it, right? But I don't just jump ahead, right? It's not something that you can shortcut. He needs to pray for them first to be settled in their relationship with God. If someone's floundering on the fence between, I guess maybe God's real and all this is real, or I don't know, maybe if it's not, those people are not founded, they're not fortified, they're not going to move on to these other things. They want to skip these things and just show me the love of Christ. But first, you've got to start with the first thing. Be founded, be grounded, be unmovable in your faith, because it all starts with faith. Then you'll be in the position to see and grasp the immensity of the love of Christ. And you think you've reached the goal, but you haven't. Then, once you've got the love of Christ in your head, you've settled in long enough, then you're in the place where what's happening? You're being filled up with good stuff, happiness, butterflies, rainbows. What are you being filled with? Fullness of God. Does somebody hear in that the ultimate goal of salvation? I mean, this is the ultimate goal of salvation. So picture it maybe this way. Here's my first illustration. Do you like my chair? This is my comfy chair. Does it look pretty comfy? Somebody's like, throw those pillows on the floor and then it's comfy. Or scatter some popcorn in there and then it's comfy. I don't know. This is our comfy chair today. So picture the first illustration this way. For me as an individual, what does this prayer mean? It means that if instead of just these quick little, I'm really busy, God, but here's a memo for you, something you need to do for me today. Instead of those little things, if I will regularly find some time to sit down, not on the edge of this chair, but how? Help me out. Settle into that thing. Sink down into that thing, right? Sink so far into it that you might accidentally fall asleep, right? You're way back in this chair. You've settled into it. In other words, you're going nowhere. This is what I'm doing for the next hour, whatever. This is where I am. And I'm even comfortable with, you know, I'm sitting here and they're not saying anything and I'm not saying anything, but that's fine. That's how unhurried this is. It isn't sit down, Lord, I've got an agenda. Point A, you need to do this, 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 and this. Okay, I'm done. See you later. Instead of that, it's settle down. Settle down in your relationship with Father God. Settle down there. Be fortified in that spot. Let nothing move you from that spot. And then after you're there long enough, you begin to get an idea as you look into his eyes of how much he loves you. And then you don't realize it, but you've begun to move beyond that to he's filling me with his presence. And then I walk away from that time, and people can say, hey, somebody lives there. Somebody's home there. And I can see there's something different on you. Your lifestyle is changing. Your demeanor has changed. You're no longer busy running around fretting, and you're no longer this angry grump or complainer all the time. Something has happened inside of you, hasn't it? Yes, you've been filled with the fullness of God that happens through these quiet, unhurried times of prayer in the Lord's presence. And this is the ultimate salvation goal. You see, I thought heaven was. Yeah, heaven is, because it's this. It is from the very beginning, God has desired to take a human being and to have a relationship with him. to just be present with them, to walk with them. You know, we're all about doing all these things and making all these things happen. And the Lord's just like, I just want to visit with you. I just want to be with you. And so he accomplishes that now, right? And he accomplishes that without obstacle, without geographical distance, without sin in the new creation too. But this is the ultimate salvation goal, being filled with the fullness of God. You'll find it time and time again in the book of Ephesians and in the other epistles in the New Testament as well. In fact, I don't want to get ahead of myself. But anyway, the first thing is this. Paul is praying this way. Father God, fortify you so that you can grasp the love of Christ and reach the goal of being filled with God. That's the first one. My big comfy chair is the first one. Here's the second one, though, and the one that I think is more important. And it is, what does this prayer mean to us as a congregation? Because we've discussed this before, that what is exciting about the church is that the church together can do these things and be this thing that makes up for what is lacking in any one of us individually. It's not what's so awesome about an individual Christian. It's what's so awesome when you get a group of Christians together. Something different happens. This is in the Bible, right? It's not just a mystery or phenomenon. This is in the Bible. When you get the church together, it becomes something different. And I want to show you what that is. And then the church is able to do something amazing, something really special. Now, individually, you know, all the lost people will say, well, so-and-so is a hypocrite, so-and-so is this flaw, so-and-so is that flaw. And you're like, yeah, we do have these flaws. But you put us together in the same room, and the Spirit's filling us. Things happen in that congregation that cannot happen anywhere else. It cannot happen in my prayer times in the forest or in my own little prayer closet. It can't happen there the way it can happen when we are gathered as a group. This is what the Bible teaches. So this is the part I want to hang on here at the end, because every you in this passage is a you all. We've talked about this before, and this happens throughout the epistles. If you write in your Bible, on the very first page of Ephesians, where it has the title at the top, underneath of it, in quotes, write, you all. Then go to Philippians and do the same thing. And then go to Colossians and do the same thing. Then go to Corinthians to do the same thing. Then go to Galatians, do the same thing. Romans, do the same thing. Every single epistle that we have, almost every single one, with the exception of like Philemon, every single one is written to a church. And every one that's written to a church, every you in there, I guarantee it, every you is a you all. It's a second person plural. When Paul is writing to these people and you see the word you, I immediately think Trey, because I'm egotistical 21st century American. Everything in here is, he's talking about Trey. It's all about Trey. But really, every single you in here is you all. Help me out with that. Let's make it into a contraction. It really should be y'all. Now that would be good English. Now, if King Jimmy were here, he would say, hey, I took care of that for you guys, but y'all got rid of it. You said it was out of date. King Jimmy, you could look at it and you could tell in the King James Version whether it's a you plural or you singular, whether it's thee or thou or ye or you, right? But in English, modern English, you can't. So pretty much tell you, every time you see a you, it's a you all. In other words, he's not talking to one person, he's talking to specifically the whole congregation of Ephesus, right? Of the Christians that meet in Ephesus. So, what I need to do is start seeing that first, not second. And because it does change the interpretation. Are you ready to see how? Okay, here we go. Now he's talking to you all. We could translate all of these as y'all. This passage has its greatest meaning, not for the individual, but for the y'all. The greatest meaning of this is going to be awesome. Are you ready? It's for the y'all. When you hang on with me through this, some of this is boring to some of you, I know, but hang on with this. When it comes to interpreting the Bible, context is king. It reigns supreme, right? Because words can have lots of meanings and lots of uses. It's how the word's being used in its surrounding context, the sentences before it, the sentences after it. That determines what a passage means. If you rip it out of context because you're a news journalist on fake news, then you can make it mean whatever you want it to mean. But if you put it in context, now it has the meaning that it's supposed to have, right? So if in the middle there's this sentence that maybe means something this way or this way, what you do is you read the paragraph, right? Which you would do, normally, what you would do. Context is king. In this passage, are you ready? You have an immediate context. That means what's going on directly in front of this prayer. And then I want to suggest that you have a primary context, the most important context. Two things. So here's the first. What is the immediate context of this prayer? We know it has one because Paul starts this off by saying what? Some of you caught it already. For this reason. Right? Did everybody catch that at the beginning of the service? For this reason. Well, I wonder what the reason was. Because that matters, doesn't it? Why were you praying for me just now? Because I knew such and such. What's the reason? How would you find it out? Okay, do that. What's the reason? Sorry? Right, they're discouraged. What are they discouraged about? Verse 13. Yes, Paul's in jail. Paul's in jail. He's under house arrest in Rome, which wasn't the worst kind of jail, but he was still in jail. And these folks, they were sad about it. Would you be at least a little bit sad if I was in jail? And I heard that you were a little bit sad. So I wrote to you a letter, and in the letter, I said, I want you to know I'm praying for you. Because I heard, I heard that you were sad that I'm in jail. So I want you to know that I'm praying for you. And I want to tell you that you're worth it. And I want to tell you why. Okay, so we get the immediate context from verse 13. And where does that start, this conversation about them being upset? Because we're going to have to go backwards. Let's find out what I meant by primary context. That's the immediate context. The reason I'm praying is because I heard you guys were upset. And I don't want you to be upset. And I don't want some of you to go off the rails because, well, how could God allow this to happen to such a great missionary? I don't want you guys to be that kind of people, so I'm going to pray for you. But everybody look all the way back in chapter 3 and verse 1. And what does he say there? What? For this reason. Somebody, let's see if you guys, I know some of you are studying this for the very first time, right here on Sunday morning, but you're also A-plus Bible nerds. What has happened? Look at verse 1. He has started to do what in verse 1? It's the same little expression that he used in verse 14, isn't it? What's he started to do in verse 1? What? He started the prayer in verse 1. And what happened in verses 2 to 13? You're right, go ahead. A Holy Spirit-inspired rabbit trail. Or a digression. He started the prayer in chapter 3, verse 1. And then in verse 2, he immediately did this little digression, which is important. So the prayer that he started in verse 1, he starts again in verse 14. You know what that means? That means if we want to find the context of this prayer in verse 14, yes, we have to look at verse 13, but what else do we have to look at? We got to go back to chapter 2, don't we? Because that's the context of chapter 3, verse 1. That's what comes right before chapter 3, verse 1. I know that sounds deep, doesn't it? Chapter 2, the end of chapter 2, came before chapter 3. I know that's deep, but that's why you guys pay me the big bucks to figure this stuff out. It's mysterious. Now, I think it actually begins in 2:11, but if we pick up in verse 19, we'll get it. Chapter 2 and verse 19, here is the context for the prayer. Are you ready? Now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. I mean, we're Gentiles. We're not Jews. There was a long time when we didn't have any people. We weren't part of the covenant promise. We weren't part of God's special people. But now we've been adopted into the household of God, verse 20, having been built on the foundation. Now he's talking about architecture. Hang in there. Having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. What is this household of faith built on? The gospel of Jesus Christ, testified to by the prophets and the apostles. And here we go, verse 21. In whom the whole building, being fitted together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. Wait, now you're talking, now you're back to this architecture and this building and this temple again. In whom you also are being built together for a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. That's the immediate context for this prayer. That's what inspires this prayer. And that's why he says you're worth it in verse 13. Now, hang on with me. Let's go back to our passage in chapter 3, verse 14, with all of this in our minds. Ready? The you alls. The building. The temple. The architectural image. Everybody hold on to those things? You picture them all? Put all that in your mind, and let's go back to the prayer, and this probably would be how you would put Paul's prayer there. I'm praying, it's on the screen now, I'm praying that Father God would fortify your church so that you can all grasp the love of Christ together and reach the goal of being filled with God. Hang on just a second. He says, I'm praying that you all, everybody say it, y'all would be fortified as a church, unmovable in your relationship with Papa God, because the storms will beat against your church. Storms like persecution that have landed me in jail. They will beat against your church. I'm praying that you will be unmovable, and I'm praying as a church that you all, everybody, that y'all would grasp the dimensions of the love of Christ. Together you can do this. Together you can do this. Grasp the love of Christ so that the ultimate goal would be what? Who will be filled? Y'all, the congregation would be filled with what? The fullness of God. Now, you held it in your head. The y'alls, the temple, the building, the architecture. And as you're holding that in your head and you read the end of verse 19, you're starting to see something. You're hearing something. What does this remind you of? That it would be filled, that this church would be filled with the fullness of God. We've only ever taken this as an individual application about being filled with the Spirit. We understand that as a New Testament concept, but we don't understand what it reflects from the Old Testament. Paul was a good Jew. All these guys are good Hebrews, right? They understand the Old Testament. The stuff we read in the New Testament is not just brand new stuff. So much of this is based on the Old Testament. Let me lead you there. Ready? In Exodus chapter 40, Moses builds the tabernacle, and God's Shekinah glory comes down and fills the tabernacle. So much so that the priest could not go in. The exact same thing happens in 2 Chronicles 7. Solomon builds the temple in Jerusalem, and God's Shekinah glory comes down and fills the temple so that the priest could not even go in there. Everybody see the picture on the screen? Then in Ezekiel 10, the prophet Ezekiel sees a vision of God's Shekinah glory leaving the temple in Jerusalem because of the Israelites' continued rebellion and sinfulness. What worse thing could happen? But the prophet Ezekiel in Ezekiel 43 sees a day coming a day in the eschaton, a day in the future, a day in the last days. Somebody raise your hand and say, I live in the last days. A day in the last days when God's Shekinah glory will return and fill the temple. And then you have a place like Ephesians 3:19, where we have this concept of the fullness of God. And all we've ever taken it is, well, I guess what he means is I'll just be filled up. I'll be full. I'll just live a full life. I don't know. This is not just this invented idea. This is an Old Testament image. Remember in chapter 2, verse 21, you as the New Testament people of God, here's what you are. You are a New Testament people temple. People temple. You are a temple made out of people. Each individual person is filled with God, filled with the Holy Spirit, and they're being built together as one dwelling place of God where God lives on earth. And there are a bunch of these little congregations meeting all over the world today, and each one of them shining out the light of God's glory so that the glory of the Lord covers the world the way the waters cover the seas, just as he prophesied in the Old Testament. So here's my second illustration. This is the ultimate salvation goal. A foundation is laid, foundation of faith in Jesus Christ. All of us, we eat the communion meal, we believe this thing together. Then a framework is built up and the walls are pushed out according to the dimensions of the love of Christ. Because our goal is to make disciples, which means bringing people into the household of God. They get built in as bricks, the New Testament people temple. The framework is built up in the love of Christ, the dimensions of the love of Christ. And then what happens? You finish the illustration. Then what happens? Foundation's laid. The walls are built. Roof is up. And now the light inside comes on. It's being filled up with God's presence, his glorious, wonderful light, and this is the ultimate salvation goal. Hey, I've told you guys this little, you guys know this little bluegrass, I think it's a bluegrass song. So many of you just want to burst out into singing whenever I quote it, and I've quoted it in the past because my great-grandmother used to sing it all the time. It was her favorite song, and we sing it with our kids sometimes before bed. When it's lamp lighting time in the valley. You guys know that song? Some of you guys are like, that's my favorite song. Some of you are like, I don't know, what in the world are you talking about? When it's lamp lighting time in the valley, in my dreams I go back to my home, where I'll see that old light in the window, and it will guide me wherever I roam. Right? The glow of a nice warm light tells us that someone is home. Maybe there's food on the table. Maybe that there's a warm chair just for you. The glow of a nice warm light says, stay a while. Everybody say, stay a while. God invites us to live that way. God invites us in to stay a while. He's not in a rush. Will you go in? Right? Someone near you right now has just begun to pray Ephesians 3:14 to 19 over you. Someone beside you has just started to pray. Someone's saying, I'm going to start praying for this person. And they're praying that soon the light of God's warm presence will finally fill you up as an individual and us as a church family. The presence, the glorious presence of God begins to fill us as individuals. And then when we come together, something even more special than that happens. We become people who are filled with the light of God's glorious presence. Somebody say, that hasn't been my church experience thus far. What do you say we turn over a new leaf and we admit that church is a lot more than I ever thought it was? I'm going to ask the praise team to come on up, and I want us to take a minute just to do some thinking and do some praying. Because over the years, I've had the pleasure of exposing and teaching a lot of passages that show the importance of the local church. And this is one of them. The New Covenant People Temple. That's what you are. And there are lots of other people that need to believe on the gospel and be built into these little New Testament people temples. And the love of Christ is big enough to hold them all. But the thing we need to take seriously on is that when I come to church and when I meet in this presence of people, I come filled with the Holy Spirit, not haphazardly, not going off half-cocked, not lazily. I pray and I come filled with the Holy Spirit. And when we all come filled with the Holy Spirit, God's presence lives here. And we ask one another for prayer and we seek encouragement for one another. And something amazing happens. God's light begins to shine from this place. His presence is here. I want us to take just a moment and I want us to look through this prayer. I want us to pray it for one another again, even right now. And maybe send a message to someone this week and say, hey, I'm praying Ephesians 3, 14 to 19 for you this week or today. And put it in your own words. I'm praying this for you, that the light of his presence would live in your heart and the light of his presence would live in our church family. And that light would be the heat that drives out the sin that's in our life and drives out the apathy that's in our life and causes us to finally get serious about him, or to finally just be refreshed by his love for us, because more than anything, he wants us to spend time with him, because that's what he wants from us, to visit with him, to stay a while and let him untie all those knots. All over the room, let's take just a moment just to pray and to seek the God who wants to spend time with us.